I'm from Pakistan. I did my bachelor's in electrical engineering from Comsets Islamabad, followed by master's from NUST. After that, I started my job at Telenor Pakistan, and I was serving there as a NOC officer. So after that, I came back to NUST and I started my job as a project coordinator. So I was a project coordinator for a research project. During my job at NUST, I found an amazing opportunity by Erasmus Mundus. So it was actually a scholarship. So I went to Cyprus and I was working there on an energy harvesting project. And I stayed there for 1.5 years. After 1.5 years, I went back to Pakistan. Being involved in both industry and academics, I just realized that there should be an intersection of both industry and academics at some point. So I just realized that I should pursue my career where there is a focal or common point between both industry and academics. So the best focal point which I found was Marie Curie. So I applied for Marie Curie and I got successfully this opportunity. And now I am in Athens. Being a Marie Curie fellow, I'm working on Project Painless. So up till now, it's been painless. And I hope so that it will be painless until the completion of this project. It's actually about the UAVs and the drones. In our terms, we call them portable access points. So portable means that these drones are going to be energy autonomous. So they'll be fully dependent upon the solar energy they'll use the solar energy and they'll be portable. So it's going to be flying Wi-Fi or flying Wi-Fi routers. So the concept is that in case of any disaster or flood where there's a situation when the users don't have access to the internet or they have to call the emergency services, so the infrastructure is down. So we are going to send these base stations and these access points, and they are going to provide the services so that users over there, they can get access or they can call the emergency service. Yes, there could be some other scenarios as well. For example, there's an event or sports event going on or there's a concert in a stadium where there are excessive users. So the already deployed infrastructure, it's not capable of providing the services to all those users at the same point. Like for example, if there are 50,000 or 100K users at the same point. So these drones or the painless is going to be service provider for all those users at the same point. So we are going to send those base stations or flying routers or our painless based access points. They are going to be 5G enabled and they are going to provide the services to all those users to 100K or 50,000 or more than that. Why Marie Curie? So I already told you that it's going to be a collaboration between industry and academia. So for example, if I'm talking about myself, I'm working on Project Painless. So being a Marie Curie fellow, as per SOPs of Marie Curie, I'm also enrolled as a PhD student at Aalborg University, Denmark. And being a Marie Curie, I'm working as a scientist at the American College of Greece in Athens. I'll be working on antennas, the arrays, the backhaul links, which are used for base stations. For the structure of the Marie Curie, you have to be enrolled as a PhD candidate at the partner universities. And you'll be working with the industrial partners as well. All those partners, they are prestigious. They have like state-of-the-art labs. Like for example, if it's painless, we have Nokia Bell Labs as a partner. So some of our researchers, they are working in Bell Labs. Some are working at CNRS Paris. Some are working in Lyra Electronics. A few of them are working at University College London. It's not going to be a collaboration among ESRs only. It's going to be a collaboration with other consortiums as well. Like for example, if it's painless, there are some other Marie Curie consortiums as well. So it's going to be a collaboration between those people as well. People like or people wish for being Marie Curie fellows just because of finances only. So it's not about the financial strength only. It's not only about the finances. It's about your career. It's about your research. It's about your public relations. It's about your network. You are going to work with the industrial hubs. You are going to work with the giants of industry. So just try to focus on these things. You are going to be trained by Marie Curie partners and consortium members. Generally, if someone is going to do his PhD or her PhD, he's going to be under the supervision of one supervisor or two supervisors, you can say, maybe a supervisor and a co-supervisor. But in case of Marie Curie, here it's opposite. So here, one PhD candidate or an ESR or early stage researcher, we call it, he's going to be supervised by more than 15 or more than 20 supervisors. So it's the opposite case. So they are always there to help you out. They are always there to collaborate. They are always there to guide you and to support you. So it's the whole consortium, like all the partners, all the partner coordinators, all those ESRs. So they are all your supervisors. So it means that those 20 people are guiding you. Let's talk about the preparation for Marie Curie, how you are going to prepare your documents, how you are going to showcase yourself. So the first thing and the first and the foremost thing is your CV, because so there would be 500,000 or more than 1,000 candidates who are going to apply for an announced position by Marie Curie, right? Each one would be a potential candidate, and you are going to have a competition, of course, globally. So there'll be people from around the world who will be applying for Marie Curie because of its prestige. So you have to be a unique one. You want to be selected, okay? You have to show yourself, okay? Show your skills, show your management skills, show your technical skills, show your research, show your hardware, software skills, communication skills, management skills, your time management skills, extracurricular activities that you have been doing up till now, just add them there. All these things are going to add the points, add the scores for you, and then of course it's going to increase the chances of your selection. Your CV should be strong enough that it should tell everything about you, because in the first step, if they are going to scrutinize those documents and those CVs, it's your CV that's talking about you. It's not you. You cannot tell by yourself until you are called for an interview. Your CV should be telling about you, right? Your recommendation letters, your experience certificates, your letter of motivation, all these things should tell about you, your motivation for getting Marie Curie. Some people think that they don't have research publications and they won't be considered for this for the Marie Curie position. It's not the case. Show them that what you have done in your bachelor's, maybe your course projects, your master's thesis, whatever you have done. For example, if I'm talking about myself, I presented all of my projects which I have been doing in my bachelor's, in my master's, and even my job when I was in Cyprus for Erasmus Mundus scholarship. So I showed all those tools on which I have expertise. For example, it's MATLAB, it's Proteus for PCB designing, it's a tool for antenna designing, the advanced designing system, it's CST Microwave Studios, it's HFSS. These are software tools to design the antennas and all that stuff, or the electronics related things. And then I showed them the fabrication skills. It's going to show them the technical skills, skills that you got, your research skills, your research potential, your research patience. So these things are going to add the points for you. The second most important thing after CV, it comes the letter of motivation. So you should be very clear and very concise about your motivation. There are some questions that you should answer to yourself first, and then you should describe those right in your letter. So the first thing is that why you want to get this scholarship, why you want Marie Curie, why you want that specific project or consortium project which is being offered by Marie Curie. Okay, so tell your own story. Be original. Do not copy from others, from other letter of motivation. It's been pointed out at some places. I won't mention those points by some few of the supervisors or few of the people in the network. They have been criticizing these things, that some prospective students, they used to copy the letter of motivations, or sometimes that. So be original, be yourself, give them the background why you are motivated for this, what was the actual thing that has inspired you to get this to get that specific position. The first thing is that why you wanted Marie Curie. The other thing is why you wanted that specific position for which that Marie Curie was offered. So it's the project, it's that position, or it's that it could be that topic as well, which is very related to your field of interest or to your field of expertise. So you should be specific about those things and be original. Being a Marie Curie fellow, it's not only about your research, because you are traveling from your home country to some other place where you have been appointed by the consortium. So you are going to mingle with a new culture. You are going to live with those people. You have to learn those languages. You have to adjust yourself with the new environment. So you learn a lot many things. So as part of Marie Curie, you are going to learn new languages as well. So when I attended my first meeting, or the review meeting with my commission officer, so he asked me that, are you going to learn the Greek language? And I said that yes, because I'm living, I would be living here for 3 years. And she said that while you will be giving your defense on the last day of your job and your degree, I am going to ask you in Greek. And yeah, so I have to learn Greek. And of course, I'm going to Denmark, so I'll be learning a bit of Danish as well. So, and there would be questions from me as about the culture involvement as well. So we attend the events being organized in those countries. So well, it's going to develop your network. It's going to develop your future goals, future careers. So for example, there are events by Marie Curie, like Marie Curie Researchers Nights. So it's alumni gatherings as well. So we go over there, we present our topics, we present our research, what we have been doing and what we are going to do in the future, what our project is all about. So, and we ask the suggestions, we get the recommendations from all the, from public as well. So we have public interaction on those researcher nights. We have summer schools, we have winter schools, which are organized by the consortium partners and the consortium coordinators, administrators, so which are public, and anybody can come over there, and they are allowed to ask the questions and about their confusions as well. So we are there to reply them. I'm really thankful to Consul Khanna and the team for reaching me out and conducting this interview. And I really appreciate their efforts providing these videos to support the prospective students and candidates who want to pursue their career and their research. I hope that this video is going to help you out and is going to motivate you. And in case if you need any help and assistance or guidance, so you can find me at Consul Khanna. So we'll definitely help you out. and we'll make sure that you get these positions. And if in case if you need any help, any support or guidance, you can reach me at Council Khana. We would be there. So keep watching and good luck.